Everybody, brace yourself for another episode of Six Blocks Apart.
Yay!
We have two very special guests. One of my personal favorites, Chris Bennett, and a special friend, Cheryl Bentyne of Manhattan Transfer.
Hello!
Yay! Yay! Jazz hands. We're happy to be here, and I always love to be with Cheryl. We added up, we've known each other, it'll be 41 years this fall. She had just gotten in the group, and we met in Berlin, right? She's CB1, I'm CB2, so we're the CBs, Chris Bennett, Cheryl Bentyne.
Berlin, yeah.
Yeah.
Tell them about Berlin, that was pretty amazing.
So you were playing the same show?
Well, yes, it was, I had been working with Giorgio Moroder and Donna Summer, and Giorgio actually sent me over there with this woman, Susie Lane, who was his new discovery, to do the Funk-Ausstellung. Funk is everything to do with television and radio, and the Manhattan Transfer were performing, and I was backstage with them, and we all were chitty-chatting and having a good time, and then here walks David Bowie backstage, and of course, Susie and I immediately go up to the manager that we'd made friends with and said, we want to meet David. He said, oh, well, we're all going out to dinner afterwards. You guys want to join us? And Cheryl had just gotten in the group. And so we instantly loved each other. We really got close back in L.A. But our first evening was with David Bowie, right, CB?
Yeah. Ended up in a taxi cab singing doo-wop. Don't ask why.
You were in the taxi with David. I'm really jealous, but I got to go and smoke the joint with him on the canals of Berlin. So that's my showbiz story.
That's amazing.
Manhattan. When did Manhattan Transfer form?
When did they form?
Before I was
in the group. I mean, it was 1979.
79. Okay.
They formed, and after 7 years, I came in and I formed, and I enjoyed them. I replaced.
She really brought the pizzazz. Tell me if I'm wrong. Tim Hauser was, and he was driving a cab in New York, wasn't he, Cheryl?
Yeah, yeah.
And he and Janice Siegel and Alan, who's still in the group, that was starring. He had starred on Broadway in what role did he play in
Greece?
Greece. Yeah.
Guy came in on the rope. I guess I.
Yeah.
And I forget where the name Manhattan Transfer, it was like one of the stops on the...
It was a book.
Oh, it was a book. That was right. Dos Passos.
John Dos Passos, yeah.
I remember it now.
Yeah.
My earliest recollection of the group was a song, or was it an album, called Tuxedo Junction?
That was the song on the first Transfer.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I'd just taken over this really rough bloodbath of a discotheque in Melbourne. And these people had never heard of disco.
Uh-oh.
So I'm up there playing records, and this guy fronts up on the stage and says, this is all very well, but where's the fucking band?
Oh.
And I said, it's a new age. It's called discotheque. Well, fucking all right, but where's the fucking band? So it took about a month. But the one record that broke the ice with these cretins was Tuxedo Junction. And you couldn't have seen a more unlikely bunch of people to have liked and fallen in love with that particular song.
Wow.
It was incredible. Yeah.
That's like a total opposite of what they were playing. That's interesting. You never know in Europe or Australia or anywhere. You don't have different songs pick up in different places. They just gravitate to different cultures. It's real interesting.
Were you, Cheryl, were you touring before the pandemic?
Yes. In fact, I still haven't got an antibody test because get this, we were in Italy in January on my birthday. We were working at a club, club, for like 4 nights. And it was a big club, but it was full and there were people everywhere, blah, blah, blah. And then we went to Florida to do some gigs, and that's when it shut down, but we were stuck there. So, you know, being in Italy, it's like, uh-oh. You know, I had a test, I'm fine, but that's cutting it a little close.
Yeah, though. That's...
And you guys were supposed to be at the McCallum this spring, weren't you, love?
Yeah, everything, you know.
Yeah.
We're supposed to be in Honolulu.
Yeah, we were supposed to be in Honolulu.
Really?
Today.
You know, Tim's the keyboard player with Rick Springfield, right? And did you guys have a lot of tours planned, Tim?
Yeah, this was the most booked solid tour. We were going to be playing with Chicago the whole summer. We had all these huge tour dates. I mean, it was going to be solid, like barely home. And it's the whole thing's obviously went away.
And Melissa's the backup dancer.
Yeah.
I wish. I don't see our group going out for quite a while because, you know.
Really?
Some of us have, you know, compromised immune system.
Yeah.
You know, all that stuff. Yeah.
Right.
I want to stay here and just go swimming at Chris's.
Yeah. when CB told me she was moving either to Nashville or Palm Springs, I said, no question. Too many damn songwriters in Nashville. It's too muggy. There's bugs. You got to come to Palm Springs. And you like it, CB. You don't regret your
love it. You've been singing the praises of this place forever since you moved here. And I thought, I've never seen a town in my life. Ever.
It's really thanks to Garrick. I would never have moved here without Garrick and his late husband, Tony, because they moved here, 15 years ago, love?
It's been 20 years.
No.
Yeah.
Well, and I used to come here in the 80s, actually, with Brian. You know, that's how Cheryl and I, the Manhattan Transfer's wonderful manager, Brian Abnett, we also met that night in Berlin, and we're together for the next 10 years. And so I got to be on the road with them a lot. I always said it was my graduate school in jazz because I got to watch these four great performers every night and hang out with big shots and the people backstage. And I'd go on the cool tours like Japan. I wouldn't go to Indianapolis, but I'd go So we used to come here to the Ingleside Inn in the 80s, but I never in a million years saw myself living here. But then starting to come to see Garrick about 6 years ago and meeting all these cool people, and it's like, wow, people are having more fun in Palm Springs than we are in LA. And you are. We are.
No,
we were.
Yeah.
We will again. Yeah.
We were in LA a lot. And when I came here, everybody's so friendly. I was like, yeah. And my friend Gary, he goes, it's because they love being here. Look where they're living. I'm
like, yeah, they're happy to be here. Right.
Doesn't hurt.
Yeah. Both of you, how long have you been performing? I know you know each other now, you said, for 41 years. So have you been performing since you were young? Did you know that's what you wanted to do?
I'll let Cheryl start. I'm older and have a longer story.
You are not. But you probably have a longer
story. Yes, I am.
Oh, not much. Well, I started singing with my dad's band when I was in high school. He had a Dixieland swing band in a little town north of Seattle. And so on Friday and Saturday nights, I'd go out there and sing, you know, Won't You Come Home, Bill Bailey, and all those things.
Well, that was one of my biggies, too. We got to put that in our repertoire.
I can't bear any of those things. So then I did that through high school and then moved to Seattle, the big city. Then it was just a cute little town. I mean, it wasn't little, but. And then I worked, what did I do? Oh, I worked with a rock band for a minute. And then I met a swing group called the New Deal Rhythm Band. And they were goofy guys, 8 guys in zoot suits. I would do Carmen Miranda and have a real banana in my hat. Every night we'd do Tico Tico. And in the middle of it, I'd look up there and go, oh. So I ate bananas every night. In the show. You know, I had enough potassium to last a lifetime. And then managers heard me in San Francisco with the New Deal Rhythm Band. And I signed with her, Linda Friedman, moved to LA. I had a couple years of like dance lessons and singing and I did little hoot nights. I played at the Troubadour, I played at the Blah Blah. Mm-hmm. And then she said, there's an audition you might be interested in with the Manhattan Transfer. And I went, I love them. I said, yeah, sign me up. So I went and sat around Janice's piano and sang a couple tunes with them. I'd never sung with other voices, so I just knew that music and I knew them. So it just became, you know, it was kind of instant. They tell me later that it worked out well. So in the Transfer now for, as of May, 41 years.
Wow.
You know,
wow. Amazing.
Wow.
I mean, that's a tiny version, but that was it. That was my life. You know how you just have a road there, and if you don't get in the way, it just kind of drives you through it. Right. Yeah, that's kind of, I feel that's what's happened with my entire
life. Especially when you're young and you're learning how to listen to your inner voice.
You
will get on that right road.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, your turn, honey.
Well, I grew up in a little farm town called Marshall, Illinois, but both my parents were musical. My daddy was a lawyer. My mom was a music teacher, but my earliest memories, I see pictures, or maybe I don't remember, I do remember him playing the banjo and me singing in my baby bed, and supposedly I could sing harmony at 3. Oh. And when I saw the Dinah Shore show at 5, it's like, oh my God, that's what I'm going to do. I had to make every costume change with her. And it's taken me 65 years, but I'm finally doing my own TV show called Unassisted Living. And you have to be a working musician over 65 to be on it. But so anyway, I had my own dance studio all through high school. I was in every show, I played the county fairs. I was a baton twirling champion. I was kind of a ham. And then I went to University of Illinois. Oh no, you don't know, as a dance and music major, but knowing eventually I wanted to get to LA, and so I stupidly got married. It hit me the other day, I would have had my 50th wedding anniversary. Wow. Had I stayed married to this guy from Pawpaw, Illinois, I'd be living in Montana. Anyway, that was not the path. I came out here to UCLA. My husband went to Vietnam. Well, he didn't. He went to officer's training instead. And I started going out on auditions, and I got picked by Jim Nabors to be a Nabors kid. I'll never be happier about getting a gig. There were 10 of us fresh-faced young Americans, 2 black kids, and we were gowned by Bob Mackie. And Gomer was just wonderful. God bless him. He passed a couple years ago. He was such a gentleman. To dream, the empire, and he sang out the side of his mouth, but he had a great voice, and we were always included.
Golly,
thank God, that's what I was thinking. And we were his kids, and we were invited to all the parties and hanging out with Carol Burnett. And I mean, I was a hick from Illinois. It was like big time showbiz. We were headlining at the Sahara in Vegas. We were playing Reno and Tahoe. And after a year or so of that,
how old were you, Chris?
Oh, 23, 20, oh, you know, wow. I was a little young kid. And this guy said, do you want to put your nightclub act together and go to Bangkok, Bali, and Tokyo? I said, oh, I can do that. So I was way ahead of Britney Spears. I had little crop tops, and my friend did my charts, and I was seeing things like Knock 3 Times, and I Honestly Love You. And at this gorgeous, I get to Bangkok, and my picture's all over this big hotel, and I won't go into all the details, but I fell in love with this gorgeous German actor. Lied to my parents, I've got a gig, and sold my worldly belongings and moved to Berlin for New Year's Eve, 1974 into 75.
Wow.
And learned to speak German. And it was just at the time, right before I left, I'd asked this guy, Maury Lathau, he had worked with Helen Reddy. Is there anything happening music-wise? I said, oh yeah, we just signed this German guy, Giorgio Moroder, go knock on his door. And Giorgio had just recorded, ooh, love to love you, baby. And before I knew it, I was a disco queen. Woo! Not really. I had to sing, as I call them, Donna's Rejects, because Donna was instantly a big star. And Giorgio, he was wonderful to work with. I loved him so much, but he would have said he could have taken anybody and made him Donna Summer. I don't believe that because she was outrageous. But so he'd record like 20 tracks for Donna. The best ones would go on her album. And then because I was going back and forth between LA and Berlin, and he'd come and he'd give me a tape the night before, and there'd be 10 songs about 2 keys too high. This is in the days before you could move a button and change the key. And we'd go in and do an album in a day. And when I listened to him, I kind of want to cry because I sound like a little squeaky thing, but they did well in the gay discos of Brazil. And I mean, you can't buy that kind of experience. We do an album in a day. We do 10 tracks in a day. And then he gave me a really big break. One night he came into town and said, oh, I need a lyric tomorrow. Well, what's it about? Oh, it's this guy smuggling drugs out of Turkey. Well, it was Midnight Express.
As the night is leaving, silently retreating.
And so I got a Grammy nomination for that, which that should segue into CB has what, 12 Grammys you guys have won now? I was keeping track at one time.
only 10.
Only 10?
Oh, I didn't know the story, Chris. That's amazing.
You didn't? No, that was great. And
wow.
It was just a very heady time. And And then so I did, I was the lead singer of Munich Machine. And then a couple of, I got to write songs for a bunch of his other acts. And then we were going to, disco was dying. If you remember, people were getting really sick of disco and they were breaking the disco albums. And I'll never forget, we were in West Ham, and it was me and this beautiful black girl, and we were going to sing sexier, stupider lyrics, wearing fewer clothes. And it just hit me that day, this isn't what I want to do anymore. I really loved jazz. I wanted to sing jazz, or at least not stupid disco songs. And I went up to him and said, Giorgio, I just can't do it anymore. And he let me out of my contract, maybe one of the stupider things I ever did, but ultimately turned out to be great. And I was doing a lot of acting because I learned to speak German. I think I was German in a past life. So because my husband was a big star over there, I was getting leading roles in German TV shows. And I was starting to play jazz clubs. I'll never forget this one review. It says, Sie singt Jungfrau Jazz. That means virgin jazz. That means kind of pathetic. But anyway, you know, you got to start somewhere. Yeah. And then, of course, when I met Brian and Cheryl in 79, that's when I really got to delve deeply into jazz, because everyone, especially Tim, I mean, he had the most incredible record collection in the world, didn't he? Bebop and jazz, and you know, getting to meet Ahmet Erdogan and Clive Davis and hear these kids every night. You know, Cheryl's incredible soprano, Janice is amazing, their harmonies were just so delicious. So I learned a lot from you guys, I think. Come on.
Strange mood.
I love coffee, I love tea, I love the Java Jive, and it loves me. Coffee and tea and the Java and me. A cup, a cup, a cup, a cup, a cup.
You know that. Plus, we had a lot of fun.
I didn't know that.
You didn't know that?
Oh, wow.
So anyway, and then it went on from there, and then I started doing my own albums, and actually right after my daddy died, you know, because in the day when I was starting out, you didn't do an album unless you had a big deal with a record company and somebody put a couple hundred thousand in it. You know, now anybody can go in their thing and release an album, but that wasn't the way back then.
I remember in 93, Tony and I were living in Bucks County. We'd moved out of New York City. And we were living in Bucks County, Pennsylvania, like a hop, skip, and a jump away from Manhattan. You sent me the video. It was on a VHS, the video of Bus Stop. She redid Bus Stop, and it was in a totally different, by the Hollies, remember the old song?
Yeah, I remember her doing this.
Yes, and you know who produced it was Scott Jarrett, who's the brother of Keith Jarrett. And we actually very transfer-esque, this word, vocals on it. Bus stop,
bus stop, ha, ha, ha. Bus stop, ha, ha, ha. Bus stop.
What day he's there, I say, please share my umbrella.
Bus stop.
Bus goes, he stays, love grows under my umbrella. All that summer, we enjoyed it, wind and rain shine. My umbrella, we employed it, by August he was mine.
Ha, ha, really fun.
It was really hot, and I used it in about 5 years later in the Christopher Reeve event I did. And you performed it, remember?
Oh, that's right, I do. That was a great event that Garrett, you gotta tell him that it was a wonderful event. I'll never forget that.
Well, Chris did the whole entertainment. John O'Hurley was the MC, but you were out there with the mic singing, walking the runway with the models singing. It was totally different. You know, I don't do anything normal. And so it was really an unusual fashion show, but it was fun. And Chris was just excellent.
Well, thank you. We have some rare video of that somewhere, I think.
We do. But you know how I met Cheryl? She probably won't even remember this, but you had a show in LA in 87, and I designed your outfit, and it was very spacey looking.
Oh, yeah. I was a little Barbarella. I was kind of like Barbarella. I had that.
You what? You designed what?
my outfit.
And she introduced me to you, and I was like, oh my God, I love Manhattan Transfer. Are you kidding? It was, I think it was like 87. Yeah.
We were in our spacesuit era too. Jean-Paul Gaultier did our first spacesuits before he was big time.
Oh, wow.
We went to Paris and he was kind of working with us. I remember Janice and I were crawling in the closet, picking out shoes, just taking shoes out of his closet. And he built spacesuits for us that were made out of.
I remember those gorgeous. They're on an album, aren't they?
Yeah, that diving material, that thick, squishy stuff. That's scuba divers.
It must have been so hot, though.
Oh, I probably lost 10 pounds a night.
Yeah.
And then one night, this is crazy, just short story. We were doing like a big band show and then our space show, and we had a big band behind a curtain. So we started off just kind of doing our songs with our spacesuits, Twilight Zone, da 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 da, you know, doing moves. And then we get on the top of this stage and the lights go down and the intro to like That Cat Is High starts. We unzip the suits and we had gowns and towels under the suits.
Were they soaking wet?
Yeah.
That's a little hot, right?
But I can't believe it. I cannot believe you did that stuff. It's crazy.
God, I'm surprised you didn't pass out.
I know.
Weren't you in a band years ago?
Yeah, something that I've deleted from my memory.
Were you the singer or did you play an instrument?
In the 60s. Okay, they have to hear about this.
There's three guys from school. We all went to a rather upper class boys school where you had to wear uniforms and you got caned and all sorts of shit like that. And we kind of sat down and kicked the idea around about 1965. And when we all left school, which was basically the same year, and it's not like we left voluntarily. I was told in advance, Rogers, they're going to expel you along with about 20 other people. So I never told my parents that. I just basically, I wasn't doing very well at school. I was not a student. And so I sat down with Mike and Bob and I said, look, you know, rock and roll seems to be happening. Why don't we form a band? Nobody knew how to play a fucking instrument. Nobody. I could sort of play the drums from my early days in state school. But, you know, Michael was like, he knew about three chords, I think. Bob knew three more than that, and that was it. That was the band. So every time we selected a piece of music to imitate, it had to be within the configuration of what we knew how to play. Consequently, this was not a progressive experiment. And after doing it for about, we got better and better and better. Finally, we were playing all of the school functions and getting well paid for it too. Once you got into that little circle, the public school circle, you could play a different gig every day. So we did this for a while, and finally I got sick of it. And I started kind of looking sideways, and someone said, why don't you do a bit of modeling work, do commercial work? And I said, well, what does that mean? And I said, well, you know, you just stand there and they pay you $10 an hour. And I said, okay, that's probably $10 more than I'm earning right now.
And also, you probably
went up to one of the local agencies, and they took me on, had photographs taken. I was working like 3 days later, and I was actually quite enjoying it. So then I got Michael involved in it. Bob wasn't interested. He went off and did his own thing. And so then I got sick of that and sort of moved sideways into acting. And like there was one production company in Melbourne. So I go up to meet this casting woman. She doesn't have an office. She's working out of one of the closets, got a little desk in there and a light, you know, and that was it. And she said, here's a pile
Better call Saul.
Yeah. Here's a pile of scripts. Learn one, come back tomorrow. So I came back at 8 o'clock in the morning and I'm auditioning while the janitor is cleaning around me.
Oh, that's so sad.
So she looks at me and says, go downstairs, get a contract, get a uniform, you start work tomorrow.
Wow.
That was it a TV show, Tristan? What was it, a film? Or
yeah,
a TV?
It was one of the numerous cop shows that Melbourne became famous for. And I played a cop that gets killed. That was it. I mean, it was an
unfathomable. So you never taken a lesson, had any training? You just were a natural?
I started to study it seriously over here.
I gotcha.
And back in England, I was doing a few classes, but I couldn't get into the English way of doing things, even though I was getting work. And so when I got to the US and when I quit General Hospital back in the 90s, I decided to go to acting school and learn a few things that I'd never learned before. And I got in with a guy who was really, really good. All he taught you was what you needed to know. He said, if you want to do scene study, move to New York. He said, you're never going to get that shit here. Nobody's ever going to book you to get up and do a soliloquy or a monologue. They're going to make you do cold reading, and that's what you've got to be good at. So I did. That was it. After that, I can look back.
Well, the benefit of being an actor is you don't have to have drums in the back of your car, drive them around, and then when you're done, like pick them up and load them back in the car.
Joining me here now at the Aussie Milk Bar, a lovely part of Koala Blue, a great singer and a great entertainer, Helen Reddy. And over here on my left from General Hospital, Tristan Rogers. Both Aussies. Now listen, I see a lot of things here like Vegemite. Stuff. Sing me a commercial. Sing me the Vegemite commercial. I want to hear an Australian
really
commercial.
Hear
yeah, come on. Vegemite.
One, two, three.
We're happy little Vegemite, as bright as bright can be.
Ho-ho.
We all enjoy our Vegemite for breakfast, lunch, and tea. And mothers say we're growing stronger every single day because we love our Vegemite. We all adore our Vegemite. It puts a rose in every cheek.
What do you miss most about Australia? And does your mother send you care packages?
Yes.
Does she?
Yes. A lot of the things that I see here, like cherry ripes and violet crumble
and
bars.
And violet crumbles.
And things like minties and polywaffles and cool mints. And
Jaffers,
right? A must. The one thing that I
tell me what they are.
Well, they're a small round thing with chocolate on the inside, and they've got this sort of orange flavour on the outside. And what you do is, when I was in school, we used to sit the back. You used to roll one down the wooden floor so that it went click, click, click. Now this doesn't sound terribly funny, but
but it got a
you
big
had to
laugh
be there.
And a clap.
You had to
I'm
be
sure.
there. Well.
The drummer had way more work to do than just bringing in an amplifier and plugging it into the wall. I mean, it took me a while to set up. I had to adjust things properly. And then on this one particular time that we're on stage and I'm beating away on the drums and the stage starts to sink. And apparently I had set up my drums on the weakest part of the stage. Everybody knew about it except me. Nobody told me. And like after about 2 minutes into the song, they turned around and I'd gone. I was down below the stage.
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
That was a lesson well learned, I'll tell you.
I'm sure.
I wanted to ask you about the Bobby McFerrin song you did together.
Yeah.
But before I do that, I just wanted to mention something I thought was kind of funny. I was looking through Manhattan Transfer videos on YouTube, and there's all kinds of great live performances. that I was watching you guys play on the Tonight Show, doing the Heart's Desire, and the performance. And I looked in the comments, and it said that singer really recovered like a pro after the incident. And I was like, the incident? And you were wearing like a strapless yellow, little low-cut thing. And I started thinking, this sounds to me like sounds like a wardrobe malfunction. So I started watching, and I'm like, what's gonna happen?
Oh, God.
The mic cable fell out of the mic. Yeah. And right when you were singing, it fell out, and you like recovered real fast.
I call that one of my best moments in show business. But the funny thing was, that evening, Johnny was talking to Richard Benjamin. And you remember the movie My Favorite Year?
Of course.
Yes, yes.
About live TV, right?
Yes.
So just talking about that, we come out, we do our first song. I forget what it was, some of the doo-wop. And then we go to Heart's Desire, which is a big doo-wop song. I got the best note at the end of the song in the history of high notes for ends of songs. I'm so excited. So we're standing there doing the song, and it's going very well. It's going good. And we get to the end. You are my heart's D. When I said D, I stepped on the mic cord and pulled it out. And my head goes, they're not going to stop the tape. I don't have time to get over to my partner's mic. And you see my head go out of the screen. Yeah. And I went down, picked it up. And it was a three-prong thing, if you know what that.
Yeah, you got to twist it to.
But I didn't. I went bam, and it hit right in. I went way up, and then the song. And then you can see our response. I was like, "Oh my god!"
Yeah, I saw you look back there.
In the band, yeah. They went nuts. His band, they went, "Whoa!"
Yeah, that was great.
And then John mentioned it. He said she had the presence of mind to hook up her mic again. I mean.
Well,
you had to. Oh my God. Well, I didn't know if I could. It was like the last two notes. And I went, I'm not going to miss these damn notes.
Yeah.
They're my money notes.
Money notes, exactly.
That was great.
Oh my God. Yeah, that was a good one.
And Tim, you were hoping your dress came off. I'm so.
That is why I watched. I mean, it was a strapless little thing like
I'm sure they'd stop the tape for that.
That Bobby McFerrin song. What?
Yeah. How did that come up?
The voices.
How did that even get recorded? Because it's so, I mean, he's doing all of the vocal stuff, and then the Manhattan Transfer, you guys' vocals is so awesome coming over the top, and it's such a weird thing to put together.
It really was. It was kind of my idea to do a some kind of vocal thing with that song. But not the words. The words are so hokey, So we had just met Bobby. We didn't know him very well. We knew his manager, Linda Goldstein. And I think we all said, let's have Bobby help us with this. Well, okay, why not? Don't Worry, Be Happy wasn't out yet at all. So we got it
pre. This is before, okay.
We got it pre Don't Worry, Be Happy. So I went up to San Francisco. He lived there. And sat at the piano with him, and we just played with ideas. And we didn't write anything down, which is unusual for us, because we write our music down and learn it. Well, this is like a total opposite of that. This is like, we were singing without a net under us, basically. So we get to the studio. Bobby puts his chest bass thing on first, with nothing else there. I mean, this is what he can do. And we're like, oh, okay. And he had about two or three parts. So we're just sitting there watching this going, what are we going to do? How the hell are we going to do this?
Oh, wow.
We've never done anything that was remotely independent of a song, of a melody. We always had the notes down. We always had the lyrics down. Right. So he did his part. And then at his house, he said, okay, we'll do one chorus of tweedoo, 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 with three harmony. But we just did it in the studio. We didn't have any rehearsal, really. And that's what happened. And we were scared. I could tell in the air, we were like, okay, well, now what do we do?
It sounds scary.
Kind of like minute by minute type of an arrangement. But it turned out so great. I mean, we're so lucky we got Bobby. Won a Grammy for the Charlie Parker solo in the middle that no one could ever possibly do. And it's really a little like, you know, 8-bar thing. And he won a Grammy for that. So it was kind of a special little piece of music.
Well, really
thank you all so much.
Thank you.
Six Blocks Apart, you have been two of the best guests because you're so interesting. We could go another hour.
Yeah. Oh yeah, we haven't even gotten into the really
and not even cross, never cross paths here. That's wonderful, and I look forward to the next time. Okay.
Can't wait to see you.
Thank you, guys.
Love you all. Jazz hands.
Bye.